Hello everyone, let's learn today general features and attachments of the fibula. Now you know fibula is a typical long bone. It has got upper end, lower end and intervening shaft, and the shaft has got three borders and three surfaces. Now the fibula is a lateral bone of the leg and it is morphologically homologous with the ulna of the forearm. Now this is right fibula I have, and for side determination you can see my separate video. So this is upper end which is expanded all around, and this is lower end which is flattened from side to side and expanded from before backward, and here is a malleolar fossa. Now let's see upper end. As you know, upper end is expanded all around and it has got mainly three features. Number one is a flattened articular facet. Now this flattened articular facet will articulate with its corresponding articular facet on the posterolateral aspect of the lateral condyle of tibia. Now this is right tibia I have, and this is lateral condyle, this one is medial condyle. So along the posterolateral aspect of lateral condyle you will find a similar articular facet. Let me show you. Here it is, and these two together will articulate to form a plane synovial joint, which is superior tibiofibular joint, like this. Now posterolateral to this flat articular facet, the upper end bears a styloid process. You can see over here. This is a bony projection posterolateral to the triangular surface, and this is providing attachment to fibular collateral ligament. Now fibular collateral ligament morphologically represents the degenerated part of tendon of peroneus longus muscle. Now in front of styloid process you can see a slopy area, and this provides insertion to biceps femoris in a C-shaped pattern. Now next to the head is a constricted part which is called as neck, which is continuous below as a shaft. Laterally the neck is related to common peroneal nerve, whereas medially it is related to anterior tibial vessels. Now we know the shaft has got three borders and three surfaces. The borders are anterior, medial or interosseous and posterior borders, and in between these there are three surfaces: medial, posterior and lateral surfaces. Now to identify the borders, it's a bit tricky, and for that you'll have to look for the lower end. Now this is lower end, and along the lateral aspect of the lower end there forms a triangular area over here, you can see. And this triangular area above at its apex is continuous as anterior border. So if you find the triangular area on the lateral aspect of the lower end, if you continue from its apex, that will identify as anterior border, and you'll have to trace it up to upper end. So this is anterior border. Now medial border is just next or just medial to the anterior border, and for that you'll have to look from above downward. So if you trace the anterior border first, next to the anterior border, just 2 to 3 millimeters medial to it, you can see over here. This is medial border. Okay, and between anterior and medial border is the narrowest surface, which is medial surface. It is just measuring 2 to 3 millimeters wide. So this is anterior border, this is medial border. Now medial to that there will be a depressed area, particularly in the middle part, you can clearly see this, or concave area. Medial to that concave area there is a sharp margin, and this is termed as medial crest. So first you'll have to identify anterior border, and then you'll have to move anti-clockwise. So after anterior border you will get medial border, in between these two you will get medial surface, then medial to that you will get a depressed area, and still medial to that there will be a sharp bony margin, that is medial crest, and still anticlockwise beyond medial crest you will get another border, and that is posterior border. Now if you trace posterior border below, it will reach up to the lateral part of a groove. At the lower end there is a posterior surface that bears a groove for tendon of peroneus brevis and longus, and along the lateral margin of that groove is the continuation of posterior border. So between medial border and the posterior border, this entirely is the posterior surface, including medial crest. The entire area is the posterior surface, which is the broadest surface. And between anterior border and posterior border, there will be lateral surface. Let me make it clear in a diagram. So this is a diagram showing cut section of the right leg. And you can see over here, this is cross section of the right fibula and right tibia. So we were discussing about borders and surfaces of the fibula. So beyond that triangular area, the apex is continuous as anterior border up to upper end. And next to it, if you move anticlockwise, next to it will be the medial border or interosseous border. Obviously, it is providing attachment to interosseous membrane along with the corresponding interosseous border of the tibia. And between anterior border and the interosseous border or medial border, this is the medial surface, which is measuring just 2 to 3 millimeters in upper part, which is narrowest surface. Now, next to the medial border, there will be a concave or depressed area in the upper part. And beyond that, you will find a sharp bony ridge that is termed as medial crest. Next to the medial crest, there will be a flattened area. And next to that, you will get posterior border. So this entirely is the posterior surface, including medial crest. So posterior surface is subdivided by medial crest into a medial concave area and lateral flattened area. And in between anterior border and posterior border, you will get lateral surface. Now let's see the attachments. Over here you can see anterior border in upper 3/4. It provides attachment to anterior intermuscular septum, and that divides the lateral compartment with the anterior or extensor compartment. So over here we'll get extensor muscles. Over here we'll get peroneus muscle. So this is anterior intermuscular septum. Similarly, the posterior border provides attachment to posterior intermuscular septum in its upper 3/4, and that divides laterally oriented lateral compartment or peroneal compartment with the posteriorly oriented flexure compartment. So here we will get flexure muscles. So this is anterior intermuscular septum, this is posterior intermuscular septum, and this dotted line is suggestive of deep fascia of the leg. Now the medial border or interosseous border, obviously it is providing attachment to interosseous membrane, and there is a gap in the upper part which provides passage for the anterior tibial vessels. So from posterior compartment, anterior tibial vessels will enter into anterior compartment. Similarly, in upper part, the anterior intermuscular septum is pierced by deep peroneal nerve, which is initially oriented in the lateral compartment, and then it reaches to the anterior compartment or extensor compartment where it supplies all the muscles. Now let's see attachment along the posterior surface. As you know, medial crest divides the posterior surface into medial concave and lateral flattened area. The medial concave portion provides attachment to tibialis posterior in its middle part over here, whereas this lateral flattened area in upper 1/4, it provides attachment to soleus, whereas in lower 3/4, it provides attachment to flexor hallucis longus muscle. The medial crest itself provides attachment to an intermuscular septum, which separates the tibialis posterior from other flexor muscles. Now let's see attachments on the lateral surface. As you know, it extends between anterior border and posterior border. Let me show you in a diagram. So this is a schematic view showing lateral surface of the right fibula, and you'll have to divide the lateral surface into upper third, middle third and lower third for attachments, and this will be the anterior aspect, here will be the posterior aspect. So if you see the attachments, the peroneus longus muscle takes origin from the entire upper third of the lateral surface and posterior half of the middle third of lateral surface. So this is how the peroneus longus takes origin. Similarly, from the anterior half of middle third, an entire lower third provides origin to peroneus brevis. So two muscles are taking origin from lateral surface, peroneus longus and peroneus brevis. Now let's see attachments along the medial surface. As you know, it extends between anterior border and medial or interosseous border. So this is medial surface, which is narrowest between anterior border and medial border, measuring just 2 to 3 millimeters in middle part. Now again, to understand the attachments along the medial surface, let's see a schematic view. This is medial surface of right fibula, showing upper end, lower end, anterior and posterior aspect, and three muscles are attached along the medial surface. To understand the attachments along the medial surface, you'll have to divide the medial surface into upper 1/4, middle 2/4 and lower 1/4. So in the upper 1/4 and anterior half of the middle 2/4, over here you can see there is attachment of extensor digitorum longus. Now in the posterior half of the middle 2/4, medial surface provides origin to extensor hallucis longus muscle, and in the lower 1/4 throughout, the medial surface provides origin to peroneus tertius muscle. The tibialis anterior muscle, which is a fourth muscle of the extensor compartment, it solely takes origin from tibia. Now in the lower end, as you know, along the lateral aspect there is formation of a triangular area, and basically the anterior border splits to form this triangle. So the anterior and posterior limb of the triangle are nothing but splitting of the anterior border. So if you hold it in anatomical position, the anterior limb of this splitted anterior border, it provides attachment to superior extensor retinaculum, whereas the posterior limb, it provides attachment to superior peroneal retinaculum. Now in the lower part of the shaft, medially, you will clearly see a rough area. And this roughness is because of attachment of a ligament that is termed as interosseous tibiofibular ligament, that is basically joining lower ends of tibia and fibula. Let me join both. So if you see the lower end of the tibia along its lateral aspect, there is a corresponding rough area, and these two together, they are connected by a strong ligament that is termed as interosseous tibiofibular ligament, and that forms inferior tibiofibular, which is the syndesmosis type of the joint. Now let's see lower end of the fibula. As you know, it is flattened from side to side and expanded before backward. It has got three surfaces plus one anterior border and an inferior notch. The surfaces are lateral, medial and posterior. The lateral surface is the continuation of the triangular area that we have seen below the anterior border. So this is lateral surface of the lower end, and it is subcutaneous and it is forming lateral malleolus. The medial surface bears two important bony landmarks: anteriorly oriented triangular articular facet, and this articulates with corresponding articular facet along the lateral aspect of the talus, and along with the tibia together, these three form ankle joint. Let me show you the same. So this is right articulated foot, and this one is talus, and along its lateral aspect you can see a triangular articular facet which articulates with the corresponding articular facet along the medial aspect of the fibula at its lower end, like this. And if you join tibia from medially together, these three will form ankle joint, like this. Now posterolateral to this triangular articular facet, in the lateral malleolus you can see a depression. This is termed as malleolar fossa. So over here you can see this is lateral malleolus, and over here will be the malleolar fossa. This is the articular facet. Now this malleolar fossa in upper part provides attachment to inferior transverse tibiofibular ligament, and below it provides attachment to posterior talofibular ligament. Now next to the malleolar fossa, behind lateral malleolus, there is a groove over here you can see, and this groove is lodging two tendons: the deeply oriented tendon of peroneus brevis and superficially oriented tendon of peroneus longus. So two tendons in a common synovial sheath are lodged into this groove. Lateral margin of the groove is a continuation of posterior border. The anterior border provides attachment to anterior talofibular ligament. Now, inferiorly, there is a notch. You can clearly see this. And this notch provides attachment to calcaneofibular ligament. So, along the lower end, there are multiple ligaments. Let us revise them. Over here will be intraosseous tibiofibular ligament. In the malleolar fossa, upper part, inferior transverse tibiofibular ligament. In lower part, posterior talofibular ligament. Over here, along the anterior border, there will be anterior talofibular ligament. And in the notch, there is attachment of calcaneofibular ligament. Now, if you see the shaft along the medial crest, you will get a nutrient foramen, direction of which is downward. So, upper end is growing end. And nutrient artery is given from peroneal artery, which is related along the medial crest. So, let's revise borders and surfaces of the shaft. First comes the anterior border above this triangular area beyond the apex. Then, anticlockwise will come medial border. Between these two will be medial surface, which is narrowest. Then comes a concave area. Beyond that will be the medial crest. So here this is medial crest. Beyond that will be flattened area. That is part and parcel of posterior surface. And beyond that, anticlockwise, you will get posterior border. Between posterior border and anterior border will be lateral surface. So this is regarding general features and attachments of the fibula. Hope you understood well. Thanks for watching.